explaining blockchain or cryptocurrencies, whether it's to lawmakers or just to the average person on the street, it's really difficult. It's got a lot of jargon. There's a whole bunch of words that people don't understand or that you just don't use in your everyday speech. I mean, how often do you use the word crypto anything? What happened with the internet was people just kept working on it until it got to the point where you actually didn't need to know what it was in order to use it. And it should get to the point where you don't have to use the word blockchain and you don't have to use the word crypto anything. You don't need to know what a miner is. You don't have to have a node or know what a node is. You can just pull up your computer and fire up whatever it is you want to do and off you go. The reason that I've teamed up with CIGI to work on blockchain technologies is because there are so many interesting and profoundly important questions about governance. I am an expert in international law, in particular in international economic law, and blockchain brings together law and economics and public policy and technology in a really new and interesting and challenging way. And this is the perfect test case for that, because not only do governments need to innovate in order to understand the technology and figure out what their policy towards it should be for financial market regulation, for taxation, for consumer protection, for data privacy, etc., but also the technology community that is pushing the envelope on this also needs to understand what kind of governance they need in order to continually successfully innovate and bring the technology forward. The purpose of a blockchain as a ledger is really to track ownership. That's what's unique about it. That's what's interesting about it. Does Trevor or Julie own this little slice of this asset, whatever it may be? It could be money. It could be title to land. It could be your car. It could be a bicycle that I sell you. So it's really essentially doing for assets, for things that people can own and exchange, what the internet did for the sharing of information. And blockchain allows us to transfer to one another ownership over things without having to go through a central party. The people who are sort of on the bleeding edge of innovation have realized that you can only go so far if you're not willing to engage with the lawmakers and the regulators. At a certain point, you will come up against barriers that make it impossible for you to realize your vision if you're not willing to sit down and talk to people and say, hey, this is the technology, this is how it works, this is what we want to do with it, here's our vision, this is why it doesn't fit with your existing regulatory system. We want to do something good, but because of the way that our technology works, we can't fit within your existing regulatory regime. Can you help us out here? Can you help us figure out a way to realize the policy goals that are behind the regulatory regime without having to do it in the way that it's been done in the past? And there are a lot of sectors of our lives where we have decided, you know, actually governments don't need to regulate everything. We can allow individuals to organize their lives as they see fit. As long as they don't overstep these boundary lines, we're gonna sort of create a box within which people can act freely. Where are those boxes? That's the question that we're trying to answer now, because it's a new type of box that we find ourselves in. And the set of options of what individuals can do through private ordering has greatly expanded thanks to blockchain technology. And so we have to redraw the boundaries, and we have to figure out how does the private ordering system that exists within this blockchain space relate to the public ordering system that we have in our governments. And it's inherently transnational. It crosses borders. It's jurisdictionless. It doesn't make sense to try and tie it to a jurisdiction. So how do we deal with that?